My name is Natalie Mildrow. I'm the director of the Queen's Memory Program, which is the collecting arm of the digital archives at Queen's Public Library. Our offices are at the Central Library in Jamaica, but we're always happy to come and visit Flushing. We love this library, and this auditorium especially is a great place to have a program. So the program that you're going to see today is part of a series that we're doing that's called 50 Years of Integration. And so it's really looking at all of the changes that have happened since the 1964 Immigration and Nationality Act, which has really changed the face of the United States and especially changed communities like Queens. And the reason that we're doing this as the Queens Memory Program is that we're especially interested in capturing contemporary history in our borough. So we really want to capture those stories of, you know, people immigrating to the United States, people who maybe don't feel like their story is important enough to be on record, but we know that it is. So we're really trying to especially capture disenfranchised voices. We do a lot of oral history interviewing, and we try to have a representative collection of personal histories that together tell the more complex and nuanced story of Queens and civic and cultural life here in the borough. So a big part of our civic and cultural life is in downtown Flushing, determined by the extremely diverse population, and now especially by our Chinese communities that are in Flushing. So today's discussion is going to be, there's going to be a variation on today's discussion tomorrow, and it will be in Mandarin. So if you are a Mandarin speaker, I invite you to come back tomorrow. It's going to be at the same time at 2 p.m. It's going to be from 2 to 4. And that should be an excellent program as well. So the order of today's program is going to be that we'll welcome first Dr. Philip Kasinitz to give some remarks and give us some kind of historical context around these ideas in the downtown Flushing area. And I also welcome you after the program to check out the exhibit that we have going on just on the other side of this wall. There are two really excellent historical maps. They're fire insurance maps, so they show lot by lot the downtown Flushing area. And they show it from two different time periods. So you can see this immediate area around the library and see how it's changed pre and post Immigration and Nationality Act. So to give you a little background on Dr. Kasinitz, he is the Presidential Professor of Sociology at the CUNY Graduate Center. He's chaired the CUNY Doctoral Program in Sociology since 2001. He co-authored the book Inheriting the City, The Children of Immigrants Come of Age, and received the American Sociological Association Distinguished Scholarly Book Award in 2010. His other recent works include Global Cities, Local Streets, with Sharon Zukin and Siemens Chen, and the Urban Ethnography Reader, edited with Mitchell Dunier and Alexandra Murphy. Kasinitz served as the president of the Eastern Sociological Society in 2007 and 2008, and was awarded the Society's Merit Award for Career Contributions in 2015. He's a member of the Historical Advisory Committee for the Ellis Island Statue of Liberty Museum. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Kasinitz.
Good afternoon. It's great to be in Flushing. It's great to be in Queens. And by the way, I do urge you, if you haven't had the chance yet, to go check out the exhibit outside, because some of these things, really seeing it tells you a lot more than hearing about it. And it's a great way to think about this community and how it's changed and what its future is going to be like, which is really, I think, what we're all going to be talking about today. So. Just to start, let's give some basic idea. If we want to think about how Flushing has changed, I think we were thinking about this originally with 1965 as kind of a benchmark, although come to think of it, that's now more, that's 52 years, but yeah. Best laid plans, right? Let's think for a couple of minutes about what this place was like prior to that. what was Flushing before the 1960s? And first thing to say is, well, I guess we all know, Flushing starts out as a rural Dutch village, right? It's founded, as you all know, from the Quaker Meeting House and the Baum House and some of the historical leftovers in 1645. The thing, however, for our purposes, that's really interesting to remember is that it stayed pretty much a rural village for at least the first 200 years, right? I mean, it didn't change all that much for quite a bit of time. By the late 19th century, it's essentially a fairly sleepy suburb. And in fact, isn't incorporated into the city itself until 1898, until the beginning of incorporation of the city. And I think while obviously it's an area that was growing, and the area right around where we're sitting now, you know, it had become sort of a downtown crossroads where businesses had started, the really big change to create the 20th century Flushing, I think, really starts with mass transit. 1913, you get the LIRR, the new station's put below ground in 1958. In 1927, the 7 train opens up. And suddenly, fast commuting into Manhattan really becomes possible on a daily basis, becomes practical. Now, based on my experience trying to get out here today, fast commuting may be something of an exaggeration. You're all acquainted with the 7 train. But take my word for it, compared to a horse and buggy that had to stop, you know, or before there were any highways, were actually by horse, this was pretty much lightning speed. And suddenly this area, you know, the northern part of Queens that F. Scott Fitzgerald talked about as the Valley of the Ashes, that's kind of thin between the rich estates of Long Island and the farming communities and the city, kind of half industrial, half still rural area, suddenly is now part of New York. But it's a neighborhood of commuters in New York. Downtown emerges as a major but secondary shopping area. It's not, of course, the place you go to see Santa Claus at Christmas. It's not the place, you know, you go to see the Broadway show, but it's for your weekly or even monthly big shopping trips right around where we are become the center. I should also note that with urban renewal projects, government starts to get involved. Just a few blocks from where we're sitting now, the Land Houses, a public housing project, was opened in 1952. There are other public housing in the area. So suddenly you start to get a much denser kind of housing setup. And with that, a much greater diversity in population. The population starts to look more like the population of the city and not like a population of a suburb outside of the city. Now, the biggest change, however, happens, as has already been suggested, with the Hart-Celler Immigration Act in 1965. Now, nobody intends, in the background, for those of you who've forgotten the history, some of you I could see are of my age and remember who all these people are. For the rest of you, let me just tell you, the guy in the middle is Lyndon Johnson. He's signing the act. He wasn't trying to transform Flushing. Probably this was not what was directly on his mind. However, and as you can see around him, New York Senator Robert Kennedy, his brother, Massachusetts Senator Edward Kennedy, John Lindsay, who's the tall guy, so even in the back you can see him there. All of them thinking of this as a very New York act. None of them are really thinking about what transition it's going to create in the city. But what the Hart-Celler Act does, basically, is it gets between the 1880s, with Asian exclusion, and the Hart-Celler Act in 1965, the real purpose of immigration law in the United States was to regulate the ethnic origins of the population. That's what it was supposed to do. You know, initially preventing Asians, then preventing or greatly reducing the number of Southern and Eastern Europeans. With the Hart-Celler Act and the civil rights, and remember, this is right when the civil rights bills are being passed. The same Congress is passing the civil rights bills, they're saying the reason to be included or excluded from the United States should not be race or religion or national origin. You know, immigration policy is legitimate. That's not a legitimate function of immigration policy, right? Immigration policy has other reasons to regulate, but you don't regulate based on race. Of course, they never really thought it would change the population that much. And the reason that they didn't is they put in a little twist in the act, because there were people who were still worried about greater diversity, and they said, but we'll give a huge preference to the relatives of the people who are already here. So it doesn't immediately change everything. But of course, since it also includes a certain quota for professionals, and since they hugely underestimate the number of professionals that will both be needed in the US and the number of professionals who would like to leave, particularly many Asian countries, suddenly those professionals start coming in. Guess what? They all have relatives, you know? And they have a preference to bring in their nearest and dearest. And of course, they have relatives. So within a relatively short time, the people who are admitted under hard seller start to change, and the second era of really large immigration to the United States really starts. Now, let me just say quickly, since, you know, events that are happening in Washington this week makes me always think we have to check our facts once in a while. Okay. Is this the highest immigration period of American history? Yes? No?
No.
No, we gotta know. She's my student, so she's like, let me see. We got a yes? We got shy people. Actually, it's kind of a yes and no. If you look at the total number of immigrants who come in, we are now living in the last, not the last few years, but since, say, the early 1990s, in the period with the largest total number of immigrants that have ever come to the United States. Okay. And that's a huge thing. On the other hand, if you look at it as a proportion of the population, what portion of Americans, what percentage of Americans are immigrants? No. You know, we're still nowhere near where they were at the early 20th century, although we're getting close. Okay. But in fact, the period where Flushing grew so much as kind of a commuter suburb of the middle of the 20th century is actually kind of unusual in the fact that the portion of the American population that were immigrants was relatively low. Although, of course, in New York, the portion that were the children of immigrants was very high. Okay. But the portion of our, you know, we were still not anywhere near at 1910 levels in terms of the proportion of the population. But there's a lot of people. And what did that do to Flushing? Well, first of all, population growth. Now, I should mention that since, I come over here. Can we move the podium? Wow. I hope that's better. Since 1990, the entire city has grown a good deal. In matter of fact, really since 1980. It's interesting to note, you know, the 70s, which we sometimes think of in New York as the real battle days period, was a period, the only decade really in the city's history where you had a big population decline. But by 1980, New York was just a shade over 7 million people, the city. Today it's about 8.5. So 1.5 million people in that amount of time is a pretty big growth. So, someday when you're thinking about why is it so expensive and so crowded and it's hard to get an apartment, well, there's a lot of reasons, but one of them is there's just a lot more people here than there was. Okay. However, Flushing grew more than almost any other part of the city. It's one of the, during at least the periods of 1990, it's one of the fastest growing periods in the city. In 1990, the Flushing Whitestone Census area, which is, for those of you who are experts on such things, called a PUMA, a public use, forget what it stands for. It's a census term. Grew by more than 30,000, almost 30,000 people. Which is a pretty substantial chunk. It's one of the fastest growing parts of the city. And as a result, anyone who lives here knows public facilities like this library and public space. Anybody walk here like I did from the 7 train a little while ago? You know, public is, if you think it's really crowded, you're right. And the immortal words of Yogi Berra, people who don't like to come here anymore say, no one goes there anymore, it's too crowded. There's an awful lot of people on the streets, and this, of course, for urban planners, raises all kinds of issues. How do you cope with that? Commercial space, by the way, is increasingly the face of communities. I mean, if you walk around and you see signs in a certain language, or you see certain kinds of use of commercial space, or you see a Starbucks, or somebody opens a bank, we know how to read that. In some ways, that's a much more visible sense of what kind of place a place is than the population is, because most of us don't know that automatically when we walk into a neighborhood, but we do know what they look like, what they feel like, and of course, as a result, small merchants play a huge role in shaping that kind of commercial activity. Just to give you a quick breakdown of the racial population, in 1990, Flushing was still almost 60% white. It had been obviously even higher 20 years earlier, before, you know, at the time of the 65 Act. It was about a little over 4% African American, and it had already had a growing Latino and Asian community. Interestingly, although we sometimes think of Flushing as an emerging Chinatown, at that point, the Korean population and the Chinese population were almost the same. Today, however, as we're probably not surprised to see, the white population has dropped to less than a quarter of the population. The African-American population has cut about half. And a lot of the more African-American areas have sort of increasingly looked like naturally occurring retirement communities. So a lot of this has to do with aging of the population. Not so much the people have left, but the large families are now much smaller families of more elderly people. The slightly over half are Asian, although when you think about it, sometimes our perception is that it's a good deal more than slightly over half, but really only slightly over half. Mostly Chinese, but also extremely diverse. And 2.5% don't like any of those categories. And when the census taker asked them, said something that they couldn't figure out how to code by any means. Okay? Most of this growth comes from immigration. You probably already knew that. Almost 60% of the area's population is foreign-born. What's interesting is that it used to be, you know, in 1990, when you ask, are you foreign-born, a lot of people who said yes were older whites, who were actually kind of the leftovers of the earlier migration, you know, the folks who come here as children prior to 1924. Okay. By now, most of them have moved on to Florida or their other reward, and what you're increasingly seeing is that the foreign-born percentage is really consistent to almost every age group. The old people foreign-born, the children foreign-born, only the very youngest children, people under five, are most likely to be Americans, and because they're the children of the immigrants, and so they were born here. But everybody else, we have a real broad distribution in terms of this. And in the core of Flushing, the area immediately around here, and here I'm using a different census geography, it's close to over two-thirds of the population is foreign-born, and that's the highest of any of the districts in the city that city planning wants. And in many ways, Flushing is becoming what the anthropologist Steve Vertovec calls a super diverse community, which is to say, really, it's a no-majority city. I mean, we sometimes think of there are white neighborhoods, or black neighborhoods, or Latino neighborhoods. This is an everybody neighborhood. It's probably more Chinese than anything else, but it's an everybody neighborhood. And if you look at just, and these are percentages just for the foreign-born population, slightly under half of that's Chinese. But there's Koreans, there's Indians, but there are also Colombians and Ecuadorians. There's places from Southeast Asia. There's increasingly population from Bangladesh. And what's really interesting to me is that the top 10 groups, all don't account for another 17.3%. And in other words, you know, there's a lot of folks from really, really small groups who didn't even make it into the top 10, you know, who still make up a big chunk of the population. So 100 people from here, 100 people from there. It's really, really diverse. And I think one of the things that characterizes that, Tarry, I think we'll talk about this in a moment, is that you get an awful lot of people who are very different from each other, sharing space at very close quarters. Okay. Now, just very quickly, some of the other things. Just looking at the population of Flushing recently, I was really struck by how the whole population is getting older. And it's not just one group. You know, 20 years ago, I would have said this is a neighborhood of middle-aged Asians and older whites. Okay? Today, it's an area, a neighborhood of people in a lot of age groups, but an awful lot of really old people. And the oldest old, the people over 80, are the fastest growing group. And if I were a planner who was worried about things like how crowded the stairs in the subway should be, or how long the lights would be, or what kind of facilities would be, I'd be paying particular attention to it. Because you do have a real growth, and it's true in virtually every one of the ethnic groups now, because you've got a substantial population of quite old folks. Used to be that the immigrants were younger. That's not nearly as much the case. I'm really struck by how people who are very different share space here. And you know, it's not just a matter of ethnicity. I think we sometimes, when we say diversity, we usually think ethnicity. Rich people and poor people are very close together. I mean, you've got people fighting to put luxury housing across the street from the public housing, which doesn't happen in most parts of this country. You know, people of different language groups, people from different religious groups are very close together. People of different age groups, you know, big school population, but also senior citizens. It's a complicated story. And that leads us, I think, to the question that hopefully our panelists will deal with from now on in, which is, in some ways, we're dealing with the dilemmas that are brought on by what we think of as success. For a very long time, politicians and planners in New York were always concerned with what was going to happen when the area was disinvested, when nobody wanted to be there, when the population was going up, going down rather, when crime was going up. Well, here we have a situation where people want to invest. People are dying to invest. The area is very crowded. Crime is down. Property values are up. Now, some real estate people would say, hooray, that's a success. But it's not always a success. It causes other problems. And the problems that often the people who think about these issues and do community planning aren't as used to dealing with and don't have the right vocabulary for dealing with, because they're so interested in preventing disinvestment, don't want people to run away and abandon. What do you do when too many people want in? Which seems to be what's happening. So, hopefully, we'll get some answers to that from some experts who really know this story. I should introduce the first of them who will be speaking now is my CUNY colleague, Tarry Hong. Yeah, you're next. Tarry is a graduate of MIT and UCLA. I should also mention that I believe you're also a graduate of Hampshire College.
Yes.
Which is where my daughter, older daughter, goes, as well as a graduate of Edward R. Murrow High School. Oh, John Dewey High School. Okay, So I got that part wrong. And is a professor at Queens College in the graduate school.
Thank you. Thank you, Phil, for that very comprehensive and informative introduction and to demographic, you know, very transformative demographic changes in New York City and also in Queens, and then specifically in Flushing. So as Phil mentioned, I'm a faculty member of the Department of Urban Studies at Queens College. And I'm also an urban planner. And many of the courses that I teach, particularly our service learning classes, I try to engage my students in our surrounding communities. And you know, clearly, you know, Queens College is located in Flushing. So, and it also kind of helps us to kind of really engage our students in the model of the motto of the college, which is that, you know, we learn so that we can serve. But I kind of think of my classes less service learning type classes and more as engaging in participatory action research, in which I engage, you know, our students in community studies in Flushing, but with a social justice goal, with trying to understand, you know, some of the challenges and issues that pertain to our neighborhoods that that, you know, relate to not only the tremendous racial diversity, but also issues around growing inequality that Phil also noted, that is part of the social fabric of this neighborhood. So my classes in the past, we have collaborated, I have collaborated with, you know, various Flushing community-based organizations. And in fact, you know, for some of the classes, we've actually used the Flushing Library as a meeting space, or at least a presentation space. So the library has been tremendously, you know, generous with accommodating our students when we do our field work by allowing us to use the classroom space. So one of the community collaborations was with the Minquan Center for Community Action, which is a community-based organization that does a lot of work on immigrant rights, on worker rights. It serves largely the Korean community, but it also, you know, it collaborates with other community-based organizations, as well as also working with other community residents. And the project that my students worked on with the Minquan Center was on the Flushing waterfront. So we know the density around Main Street, but the future of development in Flushing is really going to be focused along the waterfront. It was part of the Flushing West rezoning, which I think Irving is going to talk more about. But our collaboration with the Minquan Center was to find out, you know, how aware were community residents of the rezoning, of the potential rezoning, and of the potential for future development in along the waterfront, and what do they think are the most important needs or concerns around new development, you know, in Flushing. And so our students helped to collect 250 surveys, including residents and small business owners, and we made a presentation here at the Flushing Library. So last year, I should also mention that we've collaborated with John Choe as well on a project that actually had to do with the potential for installing solar panels in city-owned and multifamily buildings here in Flushing. But last year, my class collaborated with the Flushing Rezoning Community Alliance, which is an alliance that was comprised of both the Minquan Center for Community Action, as well as Faith in New York and St. George's Church, and some other local community residents, because there was, at that time, the city had started the study on the Flushing West area as a potential site for rezoning as part of the mayor's mandatory inclusionary housing program. And so our students, basically, we participated in community meetings, and we conducted research for the Flushing Rezoning Community Alliance. And one of the research products that my students produced for this class, which was just last spring semester, is a video. And in fact, one of the students, Rashad Ha, is he here, Rashad? Okay, he was a student in the class, but he had also interned with the Queen's Memory Project. So he was very well trained in conducting interviews, and in fact, we used, I think, the Queen's Memory Project's interview template. We modified it for our interviews with several community residents who was featured in the video. So I think that the rest of my time, I am going to we're going to see the video. And as I noted, this was a video that was produced by the students. Another way that Queens College, my department, is very supportive of this kind of student-engaged community research is that we were able to get a small grant to actually work with a Hunter College, a graduate student in film studies, and she was able to provide my students with the technical assistance in terms of producing a video. But the questions that were asked, the tenants that were interviewed, were part of the Flushing Rezoning Community Alliance. They were members of it. And I think that their story, which we're going to hear from in a little bit, is less the visible part of Flushing in terms of what we, as Phil noted, you know, the way that many of us interact with communities is that we see kind of the commercial activity on the street level. But there, Flushing, as also Phil mentioned, is very diverse. And so these are tenants whose narratives and experiences might not be as visible as the Chinese experience in Flushing, but still very important. And there's a lot of concern about the amount, the volume, the scale, the financing, the type of new development that's happening, and the ability of these longtime community residents to be able to stay in Flushing. And you can watch the video.
And longtime residents. The crowded streets of downtown Flushing is a crucial economic center of Queens because of its diverse retail and commercial developments. Although Flushing has long been an immigrant gateway, there are new plans to promote Flushing as the new destination hotspot. One of few remaining underdeveloped sites is downtown Flushing's waterfront area. Paul Nathan has lived in Flushing since 1985. While drugs and crime were present in the 1990s, families like Paul's planted roots in the neighborhood and organized to improve the area. As more and more real estate money flows into the neighborhood, Paul's concerns are that Flushing is at risk of becoming the next Manhattan.
It's like I read the community papers here in Flushing.
And actually, Rashad, who got a shout out earlier, is actually here in the audience now. So everybody, give a wave, Rashad. We have the pleasure of being joined this afternoon by our borough president, President Melinda Katz. I understand that she's just kind of pulled up to the curb and is walking down to join us. So while we get set up for our panel discussion, she's going to just make a couple of remarks and join us for a minute. She was at Queens College for a previous engagement, but she said that she would come and join us, so we're very appreciative. And actually, a good number of her staff, including one of our panelists, Irving Choe, today, have helped us out with this whole programming series, and we really appreciate the involvement of the Borough President's Office. It's a great privilege to be able to work with them. Give you an idea of who our panelists are going to be today, we'll have Dr. Kasinitz going to be moderating the panel, and then we'll be joined by Irving Choe, as I mentioned, from the Borough President's Office, as well as John Choe from the Greater Flushing Business Council, and also Dr. Tarry, who will be joining us. So we're very pleased to have them. So I think maybe they could come up and just take their seats and we can get started. And then whenever Borough President Katz comes in, she can join us. So please come up to the stage, panelists.
Very well made in terms of trying to provide as many different perspectives on Flushing West. As you know, unfortunately, Councilman McCoo decided to oppose Flushing West, and that planning process was put on indefinite hold. And my perspective is that we'll probably never see that type of planning process in Flushing probably for another decade, which is unfortunate because what this planning process for Flushing West would have allowed us is greater public participation in what is built in Flushing, as well as provide millions, possibly potentially billions of dollars in city investment in addressing many of the issues that I think people complain about in Flushing, unfortunately, because Flushing West is no longer on the table. We won't have that opportunity probably for another decade.
That's that brings us to a larger question, which I'm hoping you can both comment on a little bit. What do you see as the future of Flushing? I mean, as the future of Flushing in terms of the way land is being used, what general directions are there that we're moving into? What should we be watching out for? What should we be trying to encourage?
I agree with John in the sense about the missed opportunity to kind of have a community-wide discussion about exactly those issues, about the future of the neighborhood, about the different needs and viewpoints of all the community stakeholders, you know, some of whom were, you know, represented in this video. So I think that that's right. I think that with respect to the rezonings, there's a lot of concern about the mayor's approach to providing affordable housing, because the mandatory inclusionary housing plan, there were two concerns that were raised. One is that even though there would be a percentage of affordable housing, the majority of new construction would actually be market rate. That was one concern. And then the other concern had to do with the level of affordability. And I think that it was a victory, and this was a part of that kind of public discussion, that Peter Crew did agree to requesting a 40% area median income as a threshold for affordability in Flushing, which is more consistent with the median household incomes.
Thank you so much. I'd like right now to just please welcome our borough president, Melinda Katz, to the stage.
Hi, everyone. So I understand it's been quite an eventful panel so far. You know, I have the honor of being the president of this great borough of Queens, and we are an amazing place. And I just left another event that was happening where we were swearing in new elected officials who would be representing this borough as we move forward in the years to come. And what's always fascinating to me is how Queens is really this blueprint of what the rest of the country is going to look like. And we do it here. And it's amazing how many folks ask me, how do you do it here? And I say, we love every minute of it, right? We take pride in our diversity. We work with our diversity. We teach each other our languages, our traditions, our culture, and our arts. And that's what makes us the fascinating place that we are, that people want to come see. And our tourism numbers are growing, and you can see it. Exponentially, our tourism numbers are growing. Folks are coming from all over the world just to taste 10 countries' foods in an hour, right here in the borough of Queens, and you can do that. And Flushing has been such a microcosm of that growth. You know, I am third generation Queens, and I am so proud of the ties and relationships we have made throughout the borough of folks that are new Americans. And that combination is a remarkable combination. 50% of our borough is born outside the United States of America. 50%. And I'm raising my 5-year-old and my 8-year-old in the same house that I was brought up in. They are growing up in my old bedroom, literally. They tell me off from the same ledge in the same room that I used to tell my father off. And you share those stories with New Yorkers who are new, or New Yorkers that are first generation. And it's just the combination works for us. And I was looking at the pamphlet outside, Queen's Memories, you know, and yeah, those of us that remember stickball and stoop ball and all the things from our history, I love the fact that my sons are now playing all these games from all these different countries from all over the world. But there has to be real effective things to do in our communities, and the Flushing Library is one of those places that responds to our language needs and cultural needs every single day. So I want to thank the Flushing Library for that. I know how crowded it is, so I was thankful that last year we were able to allocate money for a new elevator for Flushing Library, which I'm very excited about because I always have to wait downstairs. And, you know, it's very crowded, which is a good thing. But I'm very proud of the panel here today. I want to thank them for sharing their expertise. Irving Choe has been doing land use in my office for, I don't know, 20 years, something like that. We have growth, we have development here in Flushing, but we always need to make sure that as we grow, that we are also still the borough of families, because that's what people are coming here to do, raise their kids and grow older gracefully. Thank you very much for today, and I look forward to the rest of the panel.
Thank you very much for President Katz, and actually, Tarry, why don't, since that question of balance of different kinds of development is sort of what you were getting at, why don't you continue on what you were talking about?
Right. So, So I think that while there were some very important concerns about the mandatory inclusionary housing, I agree with John. I think that that rezoning process provided an opportunity to bring together, you know, different constituents and different stakeholders in the community to begin to have that discussion and to begin to also highlight, you know, the very serious and very important kind of infrastructural needs. I mean, City Council Member Peter Koo alluded to some that really there's no development that can happen along the waterfront without addressing the pollution in the Flushing Creek. There's also, as Phil mentioned and as we all experience when we walk, you know, from the subway subway to our various, you know, places in Flushing, that the public transit infrastructure is very seriously strained, and it's so hard to imagine that there could be new growth. So I agree that that was a missed opportunity, and then I think that what is going to happen, what seems to be continuing to happen, that so we no longer have that opportunity to engage city officials in the discussion, and yet the development continues. And I think the people of Flushing, you know, are continuing to live with kind of the lack of investment in our public infrastructure and the fact that there's continuing kind of market rate commercial and residential development that is occurring.
Just really briefly, I just want to add to what Professor Hum was talking about regarding city infrastructure. One of the problems with Flushing is that we are the victim of our own success. You know, Flushing attracted many people because we had the infrastructure. We were a transit hub. We had retail and commercial facilities that allowed businesses to develop. It allowed people to come with very little capital to start a new life, to create a prosperous business, and to feed and send their children to college. And so there was a sense of social mobility that Flushing represents in the city's economy that I think is under threat. And so, and part of that threat is that the city has really disinvested in the past four decades in upgrading it, the infrastructure. If you look at the condition of the 7 train, it's totally overcrowded. The LIR station here is really embarrassing. We don't have a ferry service in Flushing, which, you know, as many of you know, the Mayor de Blasio has announced a rollout of a new citywide ferry service, and I spoke with the New York City Economic Development Corporation on Friday, and I asked them, well, why didn't you include Flushing in the new citywide ferry service? And their response was that Flushing didn't meet the criteria, and they listed the criteria, a dense urban population, a very busy transit hub, and a need for alternative modes of transportation, plus access to the waterfront. And I tried to explain to this EDC official that in terms of population, we are in a CUNY board that is probably the most densely populated in the city. Our transit hub is the largest intermodal transit hub in the city, where you have more people going from buses to trains than anywhere else. And we have a history of having ferry service in our community, you know, right from the Flushing Creek to Manhattan. So all of the things that she talked about in our phone conversation, we have. And so I expressed our disappointment that EDC didn't include Flushing in the ferry service, but I think that is an example of how oftentimes our community is overlooked when it comes to infrastructure development.
But you've only got 4 out of 4. Irving, perhaps you could say something about what you see as Flushing future.
Yeah, I'd just like to address some of the things that Tarry and John have said. I mean, they've...
I'm not a microphone person.
You know, they've raised issues about infrastructure, about the crowding and overdevelopment, those kinds of things, which are issues which are well known in downtown Flushing and, for that matter, throughout the city and in the densest areas. So it's the ongoing function of the city through its various departments to identify these issues in every single community. And while we focus on Flushing as a longtime resident of Flushing, we would like to see our neighborhoods done first. But there's a whole host of different aspects which have to be looked at as to what's going on. For the first part, I wanted to address the issue with affordable housing. If you look at it, the number of housing units that are developed pursuant to some sort of rezoning, particularly in Flushing, it's pretty small compared to what's happening in Flushing and throughout the city, where most development happens as of right. As of right means that if the property that you own is zoned for what you're proposing and you meet the building codes, you go to the apartment buildings, you get a permit, and you can start constructing. And the way that's controlled is through the zoning resolution, which identifies the particular uses and the particular neighborhoods that are separated by residential, commercial, and manufacturing, and some mixes thereof. And that's what happens mostly as far as development goes. It's only in the cases where the property that is proposed for development does not meet the zoning or the building code, and that's when it goes into public review, and that's when we have the rezonings or the BSA variance and special permit process. And that's the one of the few places where the community and the city gets to weigh in on any particular project. And other instances where it's a city initiative, such as Flushing Commons, One Flushing, the municipal lot number 3 on 41st Avenue, where it's a city-owned property and the city has direct input as to what happens there. So in those cases, Flushing Commons, it was roughly, I forget the number exactly, roughly 5 acres of land. One portion of that was set aside next to the Macedonian Church, and the building stands today, where they built 142 units of affordable housing. About affordable housing, it's understood that it doesn't quite meet everyone across the spectrum in need of affordable housing. But what that building attempts to do is try to meet some of the need, which goes across the spectrum. The way they break it down is by area median income, which is a number that's set up by the federal HUD department, and that's the basis on which the city uses to determine how many units within each band. I don't want to get too deep into the details because it gets kind of wonky if you want to put it that way. But the city is trying to address affordable housing in its way that it can in limited numbers. The One Flushing project, which is the municipal parking lot number 2 on 41st Avenue, just west of Main Street. That's 231 units of all affordable housing with senior housing. So, yes, the city recognizes that there are issues across the board for all the different bands of affordable income and for seniors. And, you know, as best as the city can, you know, we try to address it. And we're all too aware of the limiting factors, you know. And yes, the MIH program, which was approved mid-2016, is an attempt to address it and in a way that hasn't been really done before in New York City, because before that it was dependent upon either the not-for-profit service providers who build this type of affordable housing, either for seniors or lower-income people, or based on the developer's largesse, you know. So this was a way to try to you know, we're making your property more valuable. In return, you have to give us affordable housing, and that's the thought. And as flawed as it may be, or as many issues as it may be, that's the first shot. You know, one thing that we can't forget, that especially in the United States, and it's backed up by the Supreme Court, is property rights. Where, you know, the city, state, federal, they have a hard time forcing property owners to do things they don't necessarily want to do. Because we know in a heartbeat, you know, if they'll be challenged in court on Article 78 or some, you know, arbitrary, capricious is the language, action. So we understand very well that there is this situation, and, you know, how to address it has always been a problem. I mean, this is not what today's forum is about, but another issue is one of the mechanisms was something called 421A, state legislation, which gives tax credits to developers to develop affordable housing. So in the past, it may not have been used as effectively as possible to provide more affordable housing, and unfortunately that limited legislation lapsed, and we're sitting in a state right now where there's nothing. So now there's something on the table that's being negotiated, and it's up to the state legislature to act on it. So that's what I want to say about affordable housing. As far as infrastructure, transportation, schools, the streets, you know, any range that falls into that category, that's an ongoing thing that the city has to be aware of all the time, regardless of whether there's new development, old development, whatever. And the last thing I'll say about the infrastructure situation is that, you know, the ferry system that's being instituted by the mayor at this point is in its very beginning stages. There are a lot of reasons why it has not been rolled out as extensively as it might be, and one of them, unfortunately, is the cost. I mean, it does cost more to run a ferry because you have to have ferry docking stations, and then you have natural-related types of situations where you have, you know, weather where, you know, the boats may not be able to operate as efficiently as they might be if there's a fierce wind or if the ocean conditions or the river conditions are very choppy. But this is all recognized, and New York City is a waterfront town that's slowly converting from the industrial waterfront uses to the point where we are now looking at the waterfront in terms of trying to create new access points and return the waterfront back to the people who live there now that it's not as heavily used as a shipping or industrial type land. And that's a whole other conversation, but I guess I'll stop there.
Now. Could I respond? Okay, great. I think that we have to kind of acknowledge the city's role in kind of creating some of the kind of the very speculative real estate activity that's happening now in Flushing. Because in 2004, you know, shortly after Mayor Michael Bloomberg was elected as mayor, there was a plan that was released by the New York City Department and the New York City Economic Development Corporation called the Downtown Flushing Framework. And in that Downtown Flushing Framework, it identified three, you know, major transformative projects. One of them was the municipal parking lot number one that ultimately is now becoming Flushing Commons, which actually, I think that you're right, Irving, that, you know, there was some part of the land that was then HPD worked with the Macedonia Church to develop affordable housing. But I'm not sure that that was a community benefit that was directly related to the Flushing Commons development. Maybe John can speak more to that. But in any case, those three areas that were part of the Downtown Flushing Framework, which was Mayor Michael Bloomberg's, you know, vision of kind of promoting economic development largely through real estate-driven economic development, included the municipal parking lot number one, the Flushing waterfront, and Willits Point. And I think that for the most part, I'm not sure that you know, we've kind of deviated, you know, from that planning framework in terms of supposedly, you know, revitalizing these disinvested areas. What has changed, though, is that in 2008, with the housing, the financial crisis, is that the sources of financing for many of these major real estate initiatives in New York City is largely coming from transnational money. And a lot of it is coming from China. And not only, you know, through banks and bank loans, I think Phil mentioned the numerous numbers of banks, but also through an immigration policy. The 1990 Immigration Act, you know, included five employment-based categories, of which one is immigrant investors. So if you're an immigrant and you can afford to kind of invest $500,000 in a high unemployment area, then you will get a visa that will lead to a green card and citizenship for yourself and the immediate members of your family. So that's been a source of capital that has been heavily tapped by, you know, not only developers, you know, in immigrant neighborhoods, but also by, you know, the members of the Real Estate Board of New York, which represents, you know, the largest developers, not only in the city, but in the country.
Sure, just to add really quickly to what Tarry was saying, you know, the Flushing Commons project, I think, is a really critical issue that everyone here and in our community really needs to know more about. You know, it was sold by the city for $20 million, which, you know, is really below market value. If you think about how valuable the middle of downtown Flushing is. And I think, you know, the small amount of affordable housing that was built is not historically just in terms of what happened. I want to acknowledge that we have our Queens historian here, Jack Eichenbaum, who talks about the great injustice that was done to the mixed African-American and white business community when Robert Moses in the 1950s used eminent domain to tear down that part of Flushing and build a parking lot. And so just from that perspective, that entire parking lot should have been used for a community purpose, not sold to a private developer to build luxury condos and a national retail mall. And once the Macedonia Church did build the 141 units of affordable housing, they had a lottery and they received 40,000 applications for 141 units of housing. So, you know, I think that it is an example of how desperate Flushing residents are for affordable housing and how the city has really failed to address the need for housing to allow families to survive in Flushing. I just want to address one point that Irving made, which was the expensive aspect of public transit. Yes, we all agree anytime you build a public transit system, it's going to be very expensive just by the nature that it's public transit. But in the Bloomberg administration, the city actually committed an unprecedented amount of city taxpayer capital funds, $2 billion of New York City capital funds were directed to not this side of the 7 train where we have one of the densest populations, but to the west side of Manhattan to expand the 7 train into a neighborhood that doesn't have a population, that is purely speculative in nature, and that was really going to benefit real estate interests. And so I think, again, looking at city policies, we have to look at the issue of equity. Is the city committing a similar amount of city resources, $2 billion, into this side of the 7 train when it comes to expanding transit? I don't think so. And that's one of the things that I am working on as my role as executive director of the Greater Flushing Chamber of Commerce is to redirect city attention to the need for greater equity in city spending and infrastructure development, but also going back to the idea of what is the role of Flushing in this economy. It's to allow people who come to this neighborhood to have social mobility, to be able to go from working class to middle class. Very few neighborhoods in the city can do that, and we really need to preserve Flushing as a platform for middle-class mobility. And that's something that I think I would like to, you know, try and focus our discussion on as much as possible today.
Just as a quick aside, I'm also inspired by the presence of our distinguished borough historian. While Irving is absolutely right that public domain is, eminent domain is a very difficult process to go through, it's also true that the city has a long history of doing it pretty aggressively when it actually felt like it. And towards that end, it does seem to me interesting how much Flushing in particular continues, even after all this time, we talk about a half century of change, despite the massive growth of population, to be really the victim of a lot of the things that Robert Moses did, in the sense that this, you know, the attempt to create an automotive area and make this sort of an automotive node in an increasing automotive city, which, as we know, is not the way things turned out in terms of the population, but the idea of reducing density, more automobility, more parking lots, more highways, letting industrial areas by the water sort of go fallow, you know, was not only ill-considered at the time, but is particularly bad fit for what happened since, when in fact the city became less automotive and far denser in terms of population, and therefore, you know, the mass transit infrastructure became, which had been so disinvested for a long time, became more and more essential. But I would also like, oh, Irving?
A quick comment on that one. I don't know if Robert Moses' hand was on this one, but the number 7 train was not supposed to stop in Flushing. It was supposed to go all the way out to the county line. I wasn't around at that time, but I know that there was probably a lot of political pressure that they didn't want mass transit going through Northeast Queens. And from that, I think, is where the Port Washington line of the Long Railroad was built. So I think planners long ago saw the value of extending the mass transit as far as they could, but for whatever reasons at the time, it didn't happen. And at this point in time, it would be an astronomical cost to even consider something like that. So I just want to make that footnote.
But this, I think, gets us to a slightly less technical point, which I'm interested in everyone's thoughts on. There are a lot of needs. We talk about mass transit, we talk about affordable housing for the poorest New Yorkers, we talk about middle-class housing, which, you know, clearly in New York, the things that HUD thinks of as people who make much too much money for what HUD thinks of as public housing residents still have a really hard time finding a place to live in New York because we're so much more expensive than the rest of the country and because we're becoming so expensive. So there are a lot of competing needs. Right now, looking at Flushing, what do you think the needs should be? Where, I mean, given limited resources and limited energy, you know, what is it that we should be focused on?
I think that we should be focused on trying to protect the affordable housing that exists in Flushing, and that includes the two public housing complexes that are here in Flushing, but it also includes the rent-stabilized housing stock. So, and I think that the trends right now are, you know, indicate a really important struggle for tenant rights and tenant protections, because the trend is that there are, you know, large private equity investment companies that see the rent stabilized housing stock in Flushing as a good investment, not necessarily about, you know, providing, you know, good quality affordable housing for Flushing tenants. So you see more and more of the Flushing's rent-stabilized housing stock being purchased by groups like Pinnacle that have already, you know, been indicted on tremendous, you know, kind of slumlord-type behaviors. There's treetop development. So increasingly, the landlords in Flushing are private equity investment companies. And so I think that that makes you know, the challenge of organizing, you know, a very mixed, multiracial, multilingual tenant population. You know, it makes it a huge challenge, but an imperative to do, to engage in.
As far as the rent stabilization, I really don't know a lot about that. What I can say is that I know that in the last 5-10 years at least, that one of the ways that the trying to address, you know, there's not a lot of land available in New York City, and that's part of the issue, that, you know, land is so expensive. Given that manufacturing has left many parts of New York City, and there are some manufacturing parcels left, such as, you know, parts of the Flushing waterfront, you know, the idea has been to try to spread it out a little bit and try to, you know, serve both purposes of revitalizing the waterfront, providing waterfront access, and also getting affordable housing in there, which was sort of the thrust of the Flushing West initiative. And, you know, even that has its own little issues. You know, one issue is, while traditional smokestack manufacturing is no longer being done in New York City, we're having new emerging industries which may need loft-like spaces or, you know, that type of floor plate to operate. And the question is, where do we limit new development, residential development, for instance, in manufacturing areas? And that's a tricky question that's also being juggled as, you know, we address all these other issues.
My feeling is that the needs of Flushing are pretty clear. I think everyone in this room probably has a pretty good understanding of what we need as a community. I think what's really missing is a strategy to achieving and addressing the needs of affordable housing and infrastructure development, all the things that we've already discussed. I think part of the problem is that there is a perception and a split in this community along lines of ethnicity and race, religion, between old-timers and newcomers, primarily because the ethnic, you know, demographics has changed so dramatically. Oftentimes, I think we overlay problems in our community with specific ethnic groups, and there's a tendency to scapegoat newcomers, specifically Chinese people, for problems that I think